because this will be really useful in preparation for the board exam. Let's see what it, oh, this one I gave you also first semester. It's got a list of all of the rulers in every country, and the orders that they came in, and popes. So, as we go through, you might want to star some of the ones that are more important than others, and maybe even jot yourself some little notes. But that's also a very nice little cheat sheet. So it's got England, and even breaks them down to the ruling families, and when they ruled. There's France, there's Spain, there's the Habsburgs, there's a little graph of the French Republic. This is Austria and Austria-Hungary, Prussia and Germany, then Russia, then Italy, then the Holy Roman Empire, and then the popes. They ran out of popes after John Paul II, so you have to add your Benedict and Francis if you want to be up to date. But I guarantee there aren't any questions about either of them. You might have some on John Paul II, though. So that's useful. Let's see what else. Okay, there are some things that we'll grab, all right, because when we get to these sections of the review, remember we're covering the period 1450 to 1715 tonight. There's one that says Renaissance Study Guide, and there is one that says Age of Exploration Study Guide, and that was, and we might even add a couple. We might do a Scientific Revolution one, we might do a Reformation one or something like that, if necessary. But those are kind of additions to the 8 pages of stuff that you're going to be taking notes on. All right. The other thing that is useful are the timelines. And I've got those on the Moodle page. If you scroll down to the very bottom, you'll see a section called Timelines. And they're broken down in 50-year periods. For everybody that's arriving late, grab one of these three things, or each of these three things. Just put them on the table there, hopefully outside of Salim's view.
It's well, it's most, cool. Mostly fine.
Yeah, grab one of those three.
Chris?
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So the intent of these worksheets is to kind of go through the entire course, but obviously we're not reteaching the course in 3 hours. So you're going to have to fill in some of the blanks, obviously. Remember that I told you that the timelines are really, really important for APEuro because of the idea that you're trying to, if you remember the first exam review, I was telling you how important snapshot questions are. Does anybody remember what that is?
It's like
you're in Prussia. It is the middle of the 17th century. What's going on? Okay. Or if I said late 18th century economic movement, or if I said political developments in Stuart England, 17th century, okay, that you would have to be able to go to those places and know. If I said late 15th century, you would be able to immediately say, oh yeah, there's the rise of the national monarchies, there is the Renaissance, there is the Age of Exploration in Spain and Portugal. Or if I said early 16th century, you would say, oh yeah, that's predominantly the Protestant Reformation, and that Spain is really like big, the Habsburgs. By the end of our reviews, you guys will be able to do that pretty well. But the hardest part is to do it with the first bit of material. Because once we get to the 19th century, I think everybody's okay. It's when you get to the idea like, what happened in the 1630s or what happened in the 1530s, and find the biggest events that are occurring in those time periods and being able to put them, you know, in those equivalent places. Excuse me. So I'm going to keep this open, and then I might even open it up. But this is what you got here. And it says, as background of the modern era, summarize the chief contributions of each of the following to Western civilization. This is going to be stuff that they won't test you on, all right? In fact, the entire chapter 12 of McKay, they won't test you on. You won't have to know what the Babylonian captivity is. You won't have to know what the Great Schism is. You won't have to know about the Hundred Years' War, any of that stuff, which sucks because you spent your time learning it, but it doesn't really serve any purpose because The demarcation point in APEuro, as far as the board exam is concerned, is 1450. So anything that came prior to 1450, you don't have to kill yourself with. All right? Some of this I'm just going to be reading, and then, like I said, we'll add things here and there as we go through. But under the first thing, the Greeks, this is what they had to say. The foundations of Western civilization. So the Greeks contributed, A, philosophical thought. Okay. B, the shaping of the human mind. And then C, concepts of beauty, literature, and art. That's their gift to, I don't know, European history. So philosophical thought, shaping of the human mind, concepts of beauty, literature, and art. And remember that the Renaissance was like totally digging the Greeks and the Romans for all of their contributions. The Romans, their contribution was architecture, law, government, and then really the what they call the myth of universal empire, which several different countries across time or periods tried to emulate. Christianity, some of these I laugh at, some of them I actually agree with. Number one, spiritual heritage. Europe really is sort of born in Christianity. Concept of progress. That's one that I would sort of laugh at. And then the third one, the moral basis for civilization. And I kind of agree with that, I guess. Feudalism and manorialism provides a hierarchy. Okay? It, for the Middle Ages, that is sort of the structure, the political, social, economic, religious, cultural structure is feudalism and manorialism. Manorialism is more at the village level or at the local level. Feudalism is the entire arrangement where church and state are kind of working hand in hand to keep, you know, a subordinated population. Okay? And virtually everywhere that you saw in the Middle Ages, there was a clergy, there was a nobility, there was a gigantic peasantry, and there was usually a small middle class. And obviously those things change over time. Can anybody tell me what the Babylonian captivity dash Great Western Schism was? This is another foundation for civilization, but that time period, what did it do? What was its impact? Yeah.
It was when the papacy moved to Avignon mm-hmm. instead of Rome.
Yep.
And it just ushered in an era of decadence in the church. Like, they're building massive cathedrals and stuff like that.
Okay. So the big impact, obviously, is that it's going to embarrass the church. All right? The Babylonian captivity, if you guys remember, just to give you a time period, is 1305 to about 1377. As Salim said, you are moving. Everybody that has come in late, there are three handouts here for you to grab, including the worksheet that will be the basis of our review. So if you could grab those things and then sit down, then we're good. Or if we can do it like Italian style and kind of pass them from one direction to the next.
I can pass with you.
Good. Did you give them the worksheet too?
Whoa.
Right here.
Are we all here?
Jake's pretty close.
No way.
Jake's in the shower here, does
it? So there's no point in me videoing this, right? I'll just stop the video.
Okay. He took my advice. Gave you a couple of works. I gave you some things to just kind of mark who Petrarch was. Remember that Petrarch is writing in the 14th century, which makes him really about 100 years ahead. Then there was Pico. His name was Pico della Mirandola. If you guys study this stuff and you get a Renaissance humanism question, so disappointed if you don't remember who some of these folks are. Okay? Pico's big work was called Oration on the Dignity of Man. You guys remember that one? That's almost like a position statement for what humanism was. The idea that God had kind of given human beings the ability to be whatever it is that they want to be, and that it's not denigrating God to do wonderful things while you're here on earth. Why would they give you the gifts in the first place if they weren't to be utilized? Excuse me. The 900 conclusions, remember, was his just the fact that he's probably the smartest European in the 14th century or early 15th century, and that was his way of saying that he knew everything and would invite anyone to debate. That some of those conclusions, because they were relying on Arabic, Zoroastrianism, you know, a whole bunch of different languages, a whole bunch of like Middle Eastern texts and other things, that some of the conclusions were proven to be heretical, which kind of put him under fire. But nonetheless, it showed how big and how evolved his learning was. And remember that Petrarch and Mirandola and some of the others, that they not only were putting stuff out of their own, but a lot of it was recovery of ancient texts and then kind of putting, you know, almost like footnotes or other things on those texts. Then there's Boccaccio. Does everybody remember Boccaccio? That was Decameron. It was a 14th century work, but it's the best first-hand account that we had of the Black Plague. Then there's Machiavelli. I'm going to make this prediction because last year it wasn't true, so it's got to be true this year, that I would be willing to bet the mortgage of my home that there will be some kind of Machiavelli quote that you will have to identify on the multiple choice section. All right, it's usually guaranteed. I would say that 19 out of the 20 years that I've taught, meaning that last year was the first year that it was not mentioned, Machiavelli was on the test. These are go-to questions. Machiavelli, the prince, the ends justify the means, the cunning of the fox, the strength of the lion, keep your friends close, your enemies closer, better to be feared than to be loved, all of that stuff, which is secularizing politics, meaning that a ruler is not being judged by how good or how godly they are, but how effective they are. And using Cesare Borgia as the example of sometimes you have to be pretty damn shrewd if you want to be effective as a ruler, which means you might have to strangle a couple of dudes, you know? Somebody might have to sleep with the fishes. Okay. Lorenzo Valla, an underrated and probably one of those things that if you included Lorenzo Valla in a Renaissance humanism essay, the board exam room would light up because they'd be like, holy crap, they actually studied. Valla wrote a work called On the False Donation of Constantine, which was a textual criticism of the Roman Catholic Church, who had used supposedly a document that said that Constantine had given the western portion of the Roman Empire to the church, and that he did the study and learned that the text of the document was a fabrication, that they made it up. And because the language that was utilized in the document was not part of the language that would have been there in the 4th century. So this is a big boom, like in the spirit of like a Galileo or a Darwin, in the sense that you were putting the spotlight on the church and you're saying they got it wrong. And that's a pretty big statement to make because the church doesn't make any mistakes. Okay, and that's the beginning of the floodgates kind of opening on church authority. Baltasar Castiglione, remember his big work is called The Book of the Courtier. He's dealing with the concept called Nuomo Universal. You guys remember that? Okay, so the idea of the Renaissance man, that the ideal would be that there are skilled, well-rounded people that are accomplished in a lot of different things, and that that's how they become virtuous members of the court. He also provides the sexual double standard. You guys remember what I'm talking about? Of where women are supposed to use their Renaissance education to kind of please their husband's guests at court. And so the idea of the domestic subordination of women, especially in the upper classes, becomes really pronounced during the Renaissance. Leonardo Bruni, there's not a whole lot there other than he's the father of civic humanism, which means that this is a movement within humanism that says that the Renaissance education or the education in the Greek and Roman classics is supposed to prepare one for practical affairs. Obviously talking about men, but the idea that there are duties and responsibilities that one has with their education to utilize it for the betterment of public life, something like that. All right. Then there's Laura Serretta and Isota Nogarola. Why did we mention them?
They're women.
They're women. Yes, they are. Laura and Isota, which I have never met any, so I wouldn't know. But what is the kind of tragedy of those two women? That nobody knows who they are. And part of it was because of that sexual double standard that Laura Serretta could have been Machiavelli if they had been given the same type of opportunities or the same type of support. But woman that was told because she wanted to study, you know, the ancients and wanted to learn languages, that she should blunt her pen and temper it with a file of modesty, and that the arts or that letters were things that were unbecoming of her, becomes kind of a position statement on women that tried to advance themselves. Okay? And Isota Nogarola, it was sort of the same thing, you know, that you needed to become more like a man, you know, if you wanted to study those things. And, it, you know, it's like I said, you know, I think it's one of the great tragedies of modern times, the number of people that have been denied opportunities. But you're talking about more than half of the population that has been told they can serve no public purpose. And even though that is true, you still had a number of women that were able to overcome that. Northern Renaissance humanists, remember what I told you about them, that there is a lot more criticism of the societal conditions. It's not so much about the glory of man and about secular development and everything else. These folks were pointing out flaws. Flaws in society, certainly flaws in the Catholic Church, and they were a little bit more focused on the Bible and what biblical teachings were relative to what the church authorities were kind of dropping down on them. The most important of those humanists is Erasmus. Erasmus was a Dutch humanist, the father of what we call Christian humanism. The Praise of Folly, the Greek translation of the New Testament, the kind of satire, Julius Excluded from Heaven, which is he's using real, real heavy-duty scholarship in order to expose the corruption, the lack of education, and all of the things that surrounded the Roman Catholic Church in the early 16th century. Remember that Erasmus is different than Luther in the sense that Erasmus did not want to sever from the Roman Catholic Church. He wanted to improve upon it and get it back to its original position. Luther thought he was doing that, but the reality was that Luther's would have been regarded as a revolutionary. Erasmus and Thomas More would not have supported a break from the Roman Catholic Church. Thomas More, remember, is executed by Prince Henry the or King Henry VIII for not abiding by the act of supremacy, by not saying or giving an oath to say that Henry is the head of the English Church. That's a bold thing to do, but it also kind of shows you where his position is. Utopia was his work, and remember, he was talking about this perfect sort of almost socialist community, you know, where everybody was well-learned in the Greek and Roman classics, where there was, you know, no greed, that everybody kind of shared everything. There was no need for war. John Lennon was, you know, playing the sitar, you know, that kind of thing. I don't know. It was usually George Harrison. I don't think Lennon could play the sitar, but even still. Francois Rabelais was the third, so you got an Englishman, a Dutchman, and then you've got a Frenchman, and the Frenchman was kind of a bawdy, you know, sort of wrote about like these over-the-top characters, you know, that would be exemplary or exemplify on certain segments of society. Okay, Gargantua and Pantagruel was sort of his way of saying, here is the excesses, and here is the lack of education, and here is the lack of civility. And then you can watch those characters transform as they get enriched in the classics and become more virtuous people. Okay? Then I gave you the five Renaissance art periods. Okay, and if you guys remember, obviously art is a very big component of the Renaissance, but I broke them down for you and gave you like just a handful of the artists that fit into those positions. The first of the five art periods was called transitional. It's transitioning from what we call Middle Ages art, or pre-modern art, if you will. And the only figure that you need to know in that section is Giotto. Remember, Giotto is the one that is considered the father of modern painting because he's the first to introduce emotion in art. I showed you a bunch of paintings that were Giotto's where they still had like the old gold halos like you would see in Middle Ages churches, but you could actually see expressions on the faces of the subjects. All of the themes of all of the work are going to be biblical themes, okay? And a lot of them, if they weren't biblical, then they were devotional pieces to St. Francis of Assisi, who most people believe was the most godly saint of the Middle Ages. Quattrocento, I broke them down, painters, sculptors, architects. All right, the painters, the Masaccio, remember, was the one that introduced perspective. I showed you expulsion from the Garden of Eden. I showed you the tribute money. Andrea Mantegna, Piero della Francesca, and then probably the most famous of the Quattrocento period was Sandro Botticelli. And I showed you the Birth of Venus. If you guys saw the Birth of Venus on a board exam, multiple choice, would you be able to put Botticelli? Okay. Sculptors. The big three were Donatello. Donatello did a lot of statues. He did his own like bronze version of the David statue. Verrocchio, I believe, also did a bronze version of the David sculpture. Both of them very effeminate-looking Davids. They also did equestrian statues. They did a lot of different stuff. Remember, the Quattrocento period is dominated by the Florentines. It's dominated by the Medici family. And so a lot of the work is being done in Florence. Ghiberti, I showed you the Gates of Paradise. That's the bronze doors of the Florentine baptistry. Pretty amazing stuff. Okay? And then the architect, the big one that really you need to know is Brunelleschi. Brunelleschi is the one that did the dome. Okay? And if you... what's the name of the church? Santa Maria del Fiore. Isn't that right? Okay, there you go. Haven't seen it myself. My family is not as well traveled as others. But someday, never know. Okay, High Renaissance. This was the Ninja Turtle phase, remember? This was the period after the Charles VIII's invasion around 1494 when the Medicis are kind of exiled and Florence is no longer really the host of the Renaissance. The Renaissance moves to Rome and the papacy becomes the big commissioners of the work. And this is during the time of the Orgy Pope, Alexander VI, and Papa Terrible, Julius II. Okay. So Michelangelo, Da Vinci, Raphael, if you can remember those three. I think third grade kids could probably write Michelangelo and Da Vinci were Renaissance artists. Okay, so if you can add any kind of, additional stuff to a Renaissance art essay that would include people besides Michelangelo and Da Vinci, that would be cool. Da Vinci is usually the one that is given the title Renaissance man because as a figure, he was an artist, and he did a couple of things that were semi-famous, like The Last Supper, and then that girl painting. Lisa, I think her name is. So he was also like an engineer. He was an architect. He was a ballistics expert. He was a government official. He was a foreign policy guy. He drew, maps. He drew canal locks, airplanes, submarines, a whole bunch of other stuff. He was the most ADD person in the century because he never really completed anything before he started something new. Michelangelo, remember, would say, if he gave you his business card, he would say sculptor. But as a painter, he did Sistine Chapel. As an architect, he did St. Peter's Basilica. As a sculptor, he did a lot of cool stuff. And I showed you, you know, a bunch of things that he did. But David, obviously, is the most famous statue from the most famous sculptor, from the most famous art critic. Okay? Now we truly do have everybody.
Yeah. Except
Well, Emma, yeah, but Emma's in Minnesota. So. Okay. Donato Bramante. Bramante is a high Renaissance architect. I don't know if you'll remember him, but he did this building called La Tempietà, which was a miniature version of the Roman Pantheon. And a lot of the heavy lifting was done by Bramante on St. Peter's Basilica. Remember, that was a very long project and a very expensive one. Venetian school, remember that Venice was kind of distant from a lot of the tumult that was going on in central Italy during the Renaissance. So the art sort of reflects that. Remember two names, Giorgione, Titian. They're both painters. Their scenes were usually calm, serene, and they painted a lot of fleshy nudes. All right, a lot of Venuses. Venus of Urbino, Sleeping Venus, that type of stuff. Mannerism is the last of the art periods, and remember that reflects Charles V's sack of Rome in 1527, which is sort of like the official conclusion of the Renaissance. And that was the point where the art itself in the 1530s and 40s kind of reflected the tumult, the fact that, you know, the whatever the Renaissance represented is kind of like turned upside down. So the art itself is a lot darker. And, you know, with the classical perspective and the proportions and everything that was so perfect for people like Raphael and Da Vinci, then gets completely transformed. And the two figures that represent Mannerism or the anti-Renaissance are Parmigianino and Tintoretto. And remember, Tintoretto did a lot of biblical scenes, but a lot of like dark blues and blacks and grays and really, really kind of heavy stuff. Then the Northern Renaissance, I gave you, the five there. Albrecht Dürer was a German woodcutter, and his paintings reflected, you know, horrifying things of the 14th century. One was called Night, Death, and the Devil. The other was called The Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse. John van Eck was a Flemish oil painter. I showed you Giovanni Arnolfini and his bride. There's some social criticism that's involved there. Hans Holbein was a portrait artist, English commissioned, did a lot of work for Henry VIII, did a lot of work of court figures that surrounded Henry VIII. Peter Bruegel, if you see pictures of what looks like Dutch peasants, it's Peter Bruegel. Can you guys remember that? So it's called the peasant dance or the peasant wedding or the blind leading the blind or a bunch of peasants hanging out in the, you know, in the middle of a village. It's Peter Bruegel, okay, especially if it's early 1500s. And then Bosch, if you've ever seen a Bosch painting, he is the quintessence of social criticism, budget. Hell, damnation, social commentary. I showed you a couple of things that he did. One was a triptych. That showed paradise and then showed you, all of the sin and then showed you damnation. I think you guys remember that. And then there was one, I think it's called The Garden of Earthly Delights, and then the other one was Death and the Miser, which was kind of showing you greed. But if he would have been like the painter that accompanied Dante, if that makes sense. Okay, and then remember, there's two important events that kind of give you some guiding points in the Renaissance. One is 1494, and that was the sack of Italy from French King Charles VIII, which signaled the end of Medici dominance in Florence and the coming of the Mad Monk. Does anybody remember who the Mad Monk is? Savonarola, that's right. And then the second one is 1527. 1527 is the sack of Rome from Charles V's troops. And that is in the middle of what's called the Habsburg-Valois Wars, where Italy became a battleground between the French king and then Charles, who was the Holy Roman Emperor, King of Spain, Count of Monte Cristo.
That was the move to, like, Rome and, like,
the 1494 is when it shifts. Quattrocento then transitions to the High Renaissance. 1527 is where the Renaissance in Italy is pretty much dead. Okay? So I included that. That's part of your worksheet, actually. That fits under Section 2A. Okay? So that's useful, right? You guys could use that?
Yep.
All right, good. And I'm going to give you another one shortly. All right, so let's look at B then, the modern state. This is the section of, this is the section that is part of what we call the new monarchs. Does everybody remember what that is?
Yeah.
That's roughly 1450 to 1500, and it's predominantly Western Europe. All right? So under the number one there, where it says modern state, and it says general nature, it's asking you for two things. One is general nature, the other is accomplishments of the new monarchs. All right, make sure that you write down 1450 to 1500. The first thing is that you would have a strong king. Can anybody name them?
Ferdinand
and Isabella in Spain.
Louis the Spider King.
Louis the 11th. How about England? Beginning of the Tudor monarchy.
Henry
the 7th, that's correct. Okay, so strong king, working bureaucracy. Remember, every one of them had commissioned officials. In England, they were called justices of the peace. In France, they were called bailli or bailiffs. In Spain, they were called brain fart, hermanantes. Okay. What else? Oh, end of feudalism. Meaning that remember that what the feudal age represented was strong nobility, weak king, virtually no middle class, and usurped peasantry. Because when we talked about the feudal age, they didn't refer to France. They referred to, you know, like Burgundy or Languedoc or some crap. Okay? That France looked like just an amalgam of a whole bunch of different provinces where the duke does were the ones that were in charge. Okay? And the kings were usually very weak and nominal, which is very similar to what the Holy Roman Empire looks like. The extension of royal domain to include feudal territories. That is a project of every one of them. England is the one anomaly because England is pretty much intact as a geographical thing as early as 1066. But France, it took a while to put France together so that it actually looked like France. And remember Spain, when Ferdinand and Isabella came in, it was Castile, Aragon, Granada in the south, Navarre in the north. And they had to work to put those things together. Expel the Moors or the Spanish Muslims from Granada, unite Castile and Aragon through marriage, and then wars of conquest to deal with the rest. Okay? The town crown alliance. The only reason why the kings were possibly strong was because they were able to utilize a middle class to reduce the power of the nobility. And the reason why they were able to do that in England and France and Spain was because of their proximity to the seas, which means that they're commercial. And if you can build commerce, you can build a middle class. And if you can build a middle class, you can reduce the power of the nobility. And that's why they were able to pull it off in Western Europe and not in Central Europe. Okay, accomplishments. Number one, consolidation of power. Two, more effective transportation, because they're able to break down some of the provincial barriers. Number three, the promotion of the economic interests of the king's realm. And number four, especially in Spain, exploration, which is where they were ultimately to build up their treasury. Ariana?
Can you please repeat number three?
Yeah, promotion of the economic interests of the king's realm.
Can you do one and two? Can you do all of them?
Accomplishment one, consolidation of power. Meaning they're paving the road for absolutism in all three of those states. Or at least a try. Number two, more effective transportation. And I said because they were able to reduce a lot of internal barriers, provincial tariffs, that type of thing. Number three, the promotion of economic interests of the king's realm. And number four, exploration, particularly in Spain. And remember that each of those new monarchs reflected Machiavelli to some extent, where they used crude and very effective means of trying to subordinate the nobility. Every one of them had something. Ferdinand and Isabella had the Inquisition. Louis the Spider King was named the Spider King because of the webs of deceit that he was able to weave. And what was Henry VII's contribution to terror?
Court of the Star Chamber.
The Court of the Star Chamber. Excellent. Good. And that was Roman law, baby. That was what pleases the prince has the force of law, which means arbitrary punishment and cruel and unusual punishment and torture, which was way cool in England in the 1500s. Not nearly as cool now. Although you know Harry and William have got some dungeon somewhere where they just threw people around. Kate will come and watch.
That's how you become the king.
All right. Political and economic life in early modern period. The early modern period is roughly the 1450 to 1550 type of period. Okay? And you're snapshotting each of these five places. This is a good generalization type of question. Okay, so the period that we're looking at, Spain in the 1500s or late 1400s, what you would have seen there is a strong monarchy, B, a wealthy country, obscenely wealthy country. Does everybody know why? Yeah, overseas plunder. That's a good way of describing it. And number three, little domestic economic development, which remember is going to come back to bite them because they relied on the importation of gold and silver, and that became the basis of their economy. They didn't diversify. B, France. Fluctuating power of the king. And if you go to the, if you go to the tape on this one, I can kind of go briefly through them. But remember, it started with the Dauphin, right, at the end of the Hundred Years' War. And you start to watch their strength build, okay? So it was Charles VII, then it was Louis the Spider King, then it was Charles VIII, and then it was Louis the XII, and then it was Francis. Francis is the Renaissance kind of monarch that is a contemporary of Charles and a contemporary of Henry VIII. Then, remember, they went through that period after the Habsburg-Valois Wars were over, where Henry II had the three inept inbred sons. And then, so they were weak during that period, and then they got strong again. It says political and religious turmoil resulting in divine right absolute monarchy. That's the entire 1500s for the French, all right, especially 1550 to 1600. That's the period of the War of the Three Henrys and St. Bart's Massacre and all of that stuff. And then it kind of evolves into divine right absolutism under Louis. And then he had major internal economic barriers, which would mean this is pre-mercantilism. England, they had a strong monarchy, starting with Henry VII, but really the monarchy was strong all the way up until the constitutional crisis of the 17th century. That's when we get into the Stuarts. But if you looked at the Tudors, they were pretty much strong all the way through Elizabeth. And then the Stuarts, at least the early Stuarts, were fairly strong, but then it blew up into civil war and all of that. The government promoted and protected and fostered trade. That's the one cool thing about the English, was that the government seemed to partner with entrepreneurs and explorers to try to build up their economic base. Okay? Poland, I don't know why the hell they included them, but they did. Poland has a collapsing monarchy. It is a predominantly, if not entirely, agricultural society, and they have no middle class, which means that they are vulnerable to being ripped to shreds, which happens
a lot.
A lot.
They have no
money. E, the only word that they put for Holy Roman Empire was chaos. And if you remember, that was the fact that they were broken into 300 different pieces with different political systems, different leaders. Some of them were cities, some of them were states, some of them were bishoprics. Then you added all of the fun of the 1500s so that you had religious right to choose that you could add an additional layer to. Okay? Good. Let's move on to the next thing. Since we're only on the second page and we've got a few more. We'll find a stopping point roughly 7:30. Is that cool? All right.
Someone order pizza.
Number three. It says describe.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. Number three. It says, what was the relation of the Ottoman Empire to the development of modern Europe? The answer is that it threatened the existence of Europe in the 16th century. Remember that the height of Ottoman power is in the early to mid 1500s. That's Suleiman the Magnificent, who was at the very height of Ottoman military, political, geographic strength, and was a direct threat to Charles and the Habsburgs. Okay. After that, it said that, you know, it was kind of on a continuous slide. It had sort of reached its peak in around the 1540s or 50s. By the 1680s, it was kind of moving in the other direction. Okay, and it starts with the Siege of Vienna in 1683. Okay, terms. And we've gone over some of these already, so we won't do too much there. For Machiavelli, first secular political treatise in modern times called The Prince, which was written in around 1512 or 1513. Yeah.
I'm not trying to interrupt your lecture, but if they want people to have more than that,
take 5 minutes to do it then.
Right.
We are on Machiavelli. Remember, that's The Prince. The impact is first secular treatise for politics in modern times. The second one is Hobbes. If you remember, Hobbes writes Leviathan. This is in 1651. Remember, this is the first so-called social contract theory, which means that he's not using God or divine right as a justification for rule. What he is saying is that there is a period before governance called the state of nature, and that in that state of nature, it's a horrible looking place where people are basically in a war against all. And because of that, because of how unoptimal that situation is in a world of all pitted against all, that they surrender some of their liberty in the state of nature to an authority that will protect them from themselves. You guys remember that? So it provides a justification for absolutism, but it is a secular justification for absolutism, not to be confused with divine right absolutism, which was a different work. Remember Bishop Jacques Bossuet, Politics Drawn from Holy Scripture, that was written right around the same time. The next one is the justification for constitutionalism, and that's John Locke, right? And it's called Two Treatises on Civil Government, and that was written in 1690, I believe. And remember that his version of the state of nature differs from Hobbes. He's not necessarily as down on man as Hobbes is, and believes that human beings are born with certain inalienable rights, like life, liberty, and property, and that in the state of nature, they have not really maximized their pursuits or their protection of those things, so they surrender some of their liberties to a government that can best maximize those things or protect those things. So it is more of a constitutional arrangement where the king is bound or the leadership is bound by law, to respect not just the security or protect the security of people, but to also promote and protect their liberties and their safeguard or secure their property. Yes.
Were you ready?
I'm just talking. But I would write two treatises on civil government and then say constitutional justification for rule. I was just explaining it. I'm not programmed. I just kind of. All right. Charles. Charles is an important figure in the first half of the 16th century, which would mean roughly. If I said first half of 16th century, you guys would write
1500 to 1550.
So it said Charles unsuccessfully attempted to maintain a universal monarchy. And what that means is what Ferdinand and Isabella's mantra was, which was one faith, one law, one ruler. And remember, Charles, just by being born a Habsburg, inherited one of the largest empires that you would ever see. But he was going to kill himself trying to maintain it because of wars with the Turks, wars with the French, problems with the papacy, problems with Luther, problems with the German princes, uprisings in the New World. It was too much for him to handle, and eventually he went cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs around 1556 and divided his empire. Peace of Augsburg is 1555. It's one of, maybe at least today, it is one of three treaties that you need to know. All right. In Euro, from 1550 until 1715 or 13, three treaties. Peace of Augsburg, 1555, it concluded what's called the Schmalkaldic Wars, the German Lutheran princes against Charles trying to assert their Lutheranism, which was they no longer wanted to be affiliated with the Roman Catholic Church, and that was a lucrative proposition for them, remember, that the Peace of Augsburg pretty much ends universal Catholicism in Europe because the German princes now have religious right to choose. Yes?
What did you say ended?
The Schmalkaldic Wars? Take a guess. If you're a perfectionist, then S-C-H-M-A-L-C-A-L-D-I-C. Small called it.
Yeah, we're talking about that.
Okay, Westphalia. Crazy, crazy important. 1648. It marks really the official end of the religious wars.
You said 1648?
1648, yes. It concluded the 30 Years' War. But is the first really, really big treaty in European history. The big thing is that it recognized the sovereignty of individual states, okay, which means that it's no longer paying any lip service to the church as some universal body. It concluded the age of the religious political wars. It ended the universal Catholic Church. When we did these notes, I gave you like 16 things that Westphalia was important for. All right. But remember, the other thing is that it was so devastating that Westphalia marks a demarcation point where religion is no longer really like the basis for everything. Now they are going to science and the Enlightenment. 1648 is like a dividing point in European history. Okay, let's take a look at the Reformation. Give me a time period, folks. Protestant Reformation, what time period?
Early 1500s.
Early to mid-1500s, okay? And if you don't know that, remember, 1517 gives you a year that you could throw right in the middle. What happened in 1517?
95 theses.
That's almost like saying Protestant Reformation has begun. Okay, Luther nails the theses. Theses, T-H-E-S-E-S. All right, so political causes. Number one, and this is what they give you, but it says national monarchy acquired and organized power. That means that the rulers themselves have gotten strong. In the feudal era, they were not, and that was one of the reasons why the papacy was as strong as it was. Okay. Economic causes, certainly you can put down things like the sales of indulgences. Okay. Things like exploitation on behalf of the church, of the people, for economic gain, that type of thing. Religious, obviously, you know, the religious causes are going to be concerns about salvation. Remember, Luther was consumed with how one was at least capable of achieving salvation. Remember that his big epiphany was, the just shall live by faith. Because the church had said, it's not enough. You can't just have grace from God and that saves you. You got to do all these things. And the church was able to take advantage of all these things that you have to do to project power over others. And it was starting to bend Luther out of shape. But once he came to that epiphany, then it was sort of became, well, why do we need them then? If God's grace is free, and you, as long as you believe, then that sort of gets you there, then why the hell do we need the church? And then maybe you start asking sub-questions like, what do they do with these good works? You know, how do they determine how many works is enough or sufficient? Until Tetzel gives you a price sheet that helps you understand what's sufficient. Does everybody remember all that? Okay. Contrast thinking of men. This is the second part. These are like the big four, if you will. It's not including Ulrich Zwingli, who's not, unfortunately, kind of gets pushed to the margins. That poor little Swiss theologian, you know, who happened to be, you know, walking in Luther's path at the same time that Luther was walking in Luther's path. All right. Luther, okay? Number one, justification by faith. Remember, that was a big deal for him. The second was sola scriptura. Remember that scripture is the sole authority or religious authority, the Bible. Number three, consubstantiation. This, remember, was the Eucharist. The idea that there is an inner presence of Jesus or God in the bread and the wine. The church believed that it had to go through a transubstantiation, which means that through the priest, the bread and the wine become the body and blood of Christ. And then remember that the other group believed in memorialism, which is like pouring out liquor for the homie. Okay? The homie being Jesus. Okay. He believed that the state should have supremacy over the church. That's another Luther. Calvin is the next one that's on the list. Remember that. Just remember a couple of terms. But one is the elect. Two is predestination. Remember that Calvin was heavy. This is a work of his called The Institutes of Christian Religion in 1536. And that was the big, like, theological focal point, that God had kind of once and for all determined who was going to be saved and who was going to be damned. And the people that were going to be saved were part of this group called the elect. And that in this little spiritual police state community called Geneva, that sort of seemed to be the place that the elect were flocking to. All right. The symbolic sense of the Eucharist, we said that term is called memorialism. But Calvin and virtually most of the Protestants believe that the host or the bread and the wine are really just sacred symbols, that they're not actually the body and blood of Christ. Appeal to the middle class. Remember, that was a big deal for Calvin. The Calvinist ethic, the idea that one is pious, that one works hard, that one saves their pennies, that they get up early, you know, that they work late, that they're constantly saving for the next thing, that they don't draw a lot of attention to themselves. They were very iconoclastic, meaning statues and sacred symbols and, you know, holy, you know, water and oils and incense and all of that other stuff. They weren't down with that. They didn't like stained glass. They didn't like altarpieces. They were bench, pulpit, preacher. All right? Breathe some life into the word and I'm going home. Okay? But middle class, remember, the Calvinist outfit, everybody's seen it, right? You know, black with like white brim and then maybe black hat. And everybody goes. Because loving the Lord is some serious, serious business. Right. Loyola. If you don't know who that is St. Ignatius of Loyola. He was the founder of the Jesuits, or the Society of Jesus. He is the Catholic, I guess, counterpunch to Luther and Calvin. His work was called Spiritual Exercises. It was written around 1548. His theology was faith and good works, because that's what the Catholic Church, that's where they would not budge. They believe that it's just as important to do good things as it is to believe in, like, in God's saving grace. The supranational loyalty to the papacy, meaning all people, all walks, look to the Pope as being the official head of the Christian faith. An aggressive promotion of Catholic Reformation, meaning that the Jesuits were going everywhere and every place in order to try to win souls to the Catholic team. Okay? Jesuits in Japan, Jesuits in Central Africa, Jesuits in Northern Canada, Jesuits on the California coast, you name it, Jesuits. Okay? Erasmus. Remember that Erasmus was talking about Reformation in its purest sense, meaning that the church is fine, they just got to fix what's broken and then return back to some of the original position. The importance of unity of the church for civilization, he believed that it was necessary to have that one faith. He just wanted it to do better. Okay. Does everybody understand that? Okay. If Erasmus looks at Luther and Calvin, what does he call them?
Rebels.
Revolutionaries or rebels, yes. Okay, terms. These are just some random things during the age of religious wars. And this, and some of them are and some of them aren't. But number one is the Habsburgs. Does everybody know who the Habsburgs are?
Inbred rulers.
Where do they rule?
Spain.
Where's their home base?
Spain, yeah. Austria.
Austria. Okay, and for a while, Spain, but that was only because of marriage. The original Habsburgs came from Austria, all right, and then married themselves into everybody and everything. Okay, but they are a, what's the term they use? Ruling family of the Holy Roman Empire, eventually the Austrian Empire, eventually the Austro-Hungarian Empire. They were the kings and queens of Spain. They were married into the English crown. They were married into the Russian crown. Who the hell knows what else? They were the international marrying champions of all time. Okay. The 30 Years' War, 1618 to 1648, big time war. It is the World War I of religious wars, the granddaddy of them all, the Great War. Okay. It's a religious struggle in Central Europe between Protestant and Catholic rulers. And remember, it started with the dudes getting thrown out of the top of the church, the defenestration of Prague. You guys remember that? There were four phases to the war. It started out as a localized conflict in Bohemia and eventually blew up into sort of like an international thing where France and Sweden and the Danes and everybody else were involved. And then it became what I call tidal waves of rape, where the German countryside is just getting wrecked back and forth by Spanish armies, French armies, Swedish armies, and then any other mercenary armies. And remember, back in the day, these are not standing armies, permanent salaried standing armies. These are booty armies, okay, who are looking to plunder territory and try to confiscate estates or whatever the case may be. Schmalkaldic League. This is roughly 1520s through 1550s. This is an organization of Lutheran princes that were opposed to Charles V. How many of you are starting to remember these things? Do you feel like not as stupid as you thought you might as you walked in here tonight? Okay. The Inquisition. What was the Inquisition? It's not just a Spanish thing, though. Remember that during the Counter-Reformation, it was utilized by the Roman papacy. And it's a means of using, I guess, the stick to try to maintain religious conformity. So we're going to beat the Muslims, we're going to beat the Jews, and then eventually we're going to beat the Protestants back into the pure Catholic faith. The Inquisition was kind of a, in some cases, a traveling torture chamber, especially when the Spanish started to use it against the Netherlands. Right? Anabaptists. Does anybody remember who they are?
You don't get baptized.
Right. Two things that separated them. One, they rejected infant baptism. Okay? Which means that they were godless because there was all these children walking around not baptized. Alright. The second thing is that they believed in a strict separation of church and state. And that made them dangerous because then they became almost like a cult. And they were persecuted up and down Europe. The other thing is that they were guilty by association with lower class uprisings. One of them was the German Peasants' Revolt in 1524 and 1525. Okay, they're considered like the left-wingers of the Protestant Reformation. And their appeal was predominantly to the lower classes. All right. French Civil War. This is roughly 1540s. Until about 1590. It really doesn't formally come to an end until the Edict of Nantes, and that's 1598. The French Civil War was religious wars with strong political overtones. Can't go into all the details, but remember we had different ruling families that were kind of competing over the hearts and minds of the French monarchy. They were taking advantage of a power vacuum, where the Guise family, the ultra-Catholics, were battling the Montmorency, Châtillon, Huguenot group, who were battling the Valois Catholic kings, who were trying to play the other extremist groups off on one another. So it was a massive civil war. It involved a lot of bloodshed between Calvinists or Huguenots and French Catholics. And the crown of France was usually sort of like the buying prize, if you will. All right? There was the St. Bart's Massacre, which is where the Guise family just went crazy killing Protestants. There was the War of the Three Henrys, when Henry Guise and Henry of Valois killed each other and left Henry of Navarre as the third and last Henry standing, who became Mr. Paris's worth of mass, began the Bourbon dynasty, and then said, I'm Catholic, France is Catholic, even though I used to be Protestant, but at least I will take care of my Protestant brothers and sisters by passing the Edict of Nantes so that they have religious right to choose. Yeah.
Henry Navarre married to some...
You might think of Anne. You might be thinking of Henry VIII.
Probably.
Do you mean a Medici? I don't...
Marie de Medici was who Henry was married to.
Okay.
But I know what you're talking about. No, actually that's false. Henry of Navarre, remember, was supposed to marry one of the Valois daughters so that the Huguenots and the Catholics could get together by marriage. You're right. I can't remember what her name is, though, off the top of my head. So, okay. Council of Trent. You may or may not remember this one, but this was like the quintessential thing that happened during the Catholic Reformation. It's from 1545 to 63. Trent did three things. Actually, it did one thing, and then it didn't do two others. Number one, it addressed the issues of corruption that had precipitated the Protestant Reformation. So lack of, education, clerical immorality, drunkenness, pluralism, simony, the sale of indulgences, all of that stuff. It didn't reconcile with the Protestants, which was the second thing that it was supposed to do. And the third thing it did do. It answered the challenge that was made to basic Catholic theology, like the seven sacraments and transubstantiation and faith and good works. And that means that the Council of Trent reaffirmed Catholic theology. Okay, but it's the signature piece of the Catholic Reformation. All right, let's move on. What is the importance of the opening of the Atlantic? Oh, the last one is the Huguenots. Does everybody know who they are?
Yeah.
Yeah, French Calvinists. They were named after Besançon Hugues, who was a Swiss exile dude that kind of founded them. But they are French Calvinists. The economic revolution, what is the importance of the opening of the Atlantic, is that it shifted the center of trade from the Mediterranean to the Atlantic. Trade had pretty much predominated in routes around the Mediterranean Sea. And now the Atlantic was open. And eventually the Indian Ocean, once they figured out that you could get around Africa. Number two. What goods were brought to Europe as a result of the opening? Spice, wood, furs, silver and gold. And you could ask the same question. What goods were brought to the Americas as a result of the opening?
Disease,
slavery, the plantation system, rape.
Spanish Empire?
Empire, conquistadors, encomiendas.
Horses.
That is true. You can't argue.
Horses. Thank you. They can drink some good things. A couple of oranges, I think, as well. Sorry.
Sometimes you shouldn't meet your gods.
Number three, what is meant by the commercial revolution? The answer there is that it is just nation-centered economic development. That France, you know, is going through a transition where it's trying to build up its economy through trade, or England, or Spain, or whoever it happens to be. Okay, and this process really begins with the age of exploration. So that's part of it. All right, effects of the commercial revolution on Europe. It's all about Europe. Blah blah. All right. sorry. Number one, economic. The first thing was mercantilism, which was the idea that the state itself was sort of orchestrating its economic development. The rise of the entrepreneurial class, which is you're starting to build and really kind of solidify a middle class, a skilled entrepreneurial class. And then modern capitalism is kind of like the long-term impact of that, economic impact of that. Socially, the rise of the bourgeoisie in terms of numbers and wealth. Okay, the middle class is starting to become something that matters. And it's not just the nobility and the peasants and the clergy. So the middle class is starting to become important. The political impacts, the financing of governments and armies, and that kings are more dependent on the middle class. Okay, because it used to be that they were dependent on the nobles because of landed wealth. And now it's becoming the wealth can be generated in other ways. And the middle class is what helps galvanize that. Religious impacts. Calvinism and the idea that profit could be something that you could say was godly. Calvinism sort of in its own way said that those that did well or that had some material wealth, it was as if God was kind of showing favor on the accumulation of that wealth, which is a really kind of, I don't know, how would you describe it?
Yeah.
It's a very, very messed up proposition, because then if you really look at it, capitalism kind of replaces God as the new God. All right, we've kind of gone through some stages. All right, where God used to be God, and then nationalism became God, And then kind of global finance or global capitalism became God. We kind of are all at the altar of whatever material goods you can stuff your pockets with. That was a little preachy. I apologize for that. You know, yay capitalism. what's next? Oh, religious. We just talked about intellectual, a broader understanding of the world, which encouraged scientific inquiry. That was the part where they believed that the age of exploration, because they were trying to learn new navigational techniques and improve technology, that that was sort of a precipitator, if you will, of the scientific revolution. Better charts, better map making, better equipment, better manufacturing, whatever the case may be. Define mercantilism. This is important. Mercantilism is kind of from the period 1650 to 1750 is the predominant economic thing. And know that too, because that will probably be a multiple choice question. If it's like the official economic system of the age of absolutism, which is roughly the same time, 1650 to 1750, or mid-17th century to mid-18th century. Here's the definition. State manipulation of the economic system to promote the national interest by creating a favorable balance of trade. State manipulation of the economic system to promote the national interest by creating a favorable balance of trade. If you remember that state controls all aspects of the economy for the purposes of making sure that you have a favorable balance of trade. What that means is that exports exceed imports. That means that you put tariff barriers up to make sure that that system doesn't get inverted and you're bringing in more than you're putting out. Okay? But it also is going to encourage colonization because if you tariff me, I tariff you. And then I've got to make up for my deficits of natural resources and labor markets and then markets for my finished goods by finding people that I can control, which is going to breed then colonization. And that kind of begins roughly around the middle of the 1600s. In fact, Portugal and Spain do it a little bit earlier. Okay. We're doing well, but we're going to take another detour, and we're going to look at an age of exploration map, okay? Very similar to the one that we did for the Renaissance, okay? And it's called Age of Exploration Study Guide, okay? All right, so here are some people that I think you should know. The age of exploration, if you see it, or if it's called old imperialism, sometimes they refer to it as that. The time period is 1450 to about 1600. The two dominant states early are going to be Portugal and Spain, and then by the time you get to the mid to late 16th century, then it becomes the Dutch, the French, and the English who are starting to catch up at the end. Portugal, here are some names. Bartolomeu Dias. Okay, his big claim to fame was that he found the Cape of Good Hope. He got to the bottom tip of Africa and they got blown back. That was 1487. Vasco da Gama made it. 1498, made it to India. Alfonso de Albuquerque. Jesus is born on cannonballs. You guys remember me telling you that where Buddha came to India on elephants, Jesus came to India by cannonball? That was where Albuquerque was not content to merely be a trade partner in the Indian spice trade. He wanted to control it. So they started to blow up Muslim ships. Portugal seized the Muslim ports of Calicut, Ormuz, Goa, and Malacca. Pedro Cabral, remember, was looking for India and found Brazil. And that Prince Henry the Navigator, remember, was not a navigator. He was a sponsor of navigation, and he created a navigational school called Sagres. You guys remember any of this? Good. Spain. Columbus briefly did some stuff in 1492. Hernando Cortes and Francisco Pizarro, what did they do? They conquered stuff. One of them blew up the Aztec Empire, the other one blew up the Inca Empire. Very nice. Vasco de Balboa discovered the southwestern United States, or the territory that is the southwestern United States. Ferdinand Magellan, roundabout. He circumnavigated. Or at least his boat did. Like he died somewhere near the Philippines. Hernando de Soto, I don't remember. Mississippi Valley, maybe. Ponce de Leon. Amerigo de Vespucci is Italian, like Columbus, but he sailed for Spain. And the name America is from Amerigo de Vespucci. Okay, here's some other stuff that you should know. God, glory, gold. Does everybody know what those things are? Remember that you might get a question where they ask you to explain the motives or the advantages or the causes of the age of exploration. There you go. Okay? God, which is this breakneck thing to extend the Crusades to new regions. Find Prester John, the mythical Ethiopian king. But to bring all of these poor, backward, barbaric people into the light of God. Gold, remember, is the real motive. People can get rich or they can get politically powerful. But if you say that you got humanitarian reasons for doing things, you know, like remove Iraqi despot who gasses the Kurds instead of oil profit. I'm just kidding. That didn't happen. Astrolabe, Latin sail, magnetic compass, caravel, sextant. What do we mean there? Yeah, those are all innovations that enabled the age of exploration. The biological exchange. Is everybody familiar with that? Okay. It's not just like the trade of horses and corn and all that other stuff, but it's also diseases. It's also intermarriage. All right. It was a lot of things. But it was the relationship of the Europeans interacting with Amerindian populations and then the impacts of that. The Treaty of Albacabas, the Papal Demarcation Line, the Treaty of Tordesillas. All of these treaties deal with creating some kind of rules for the game, if you will, between Spain and Portugal. Okay? Which islands do you claim? Which, you know, what is the Atlantic and what is the line where this is considered Spanish territory versus what is Portuguese? If anybody has a geography question on the test, it shows a map. Remember that most of what Spain had was either off the coast of Africa or was in the Americas, whereas most of what Portugal had was, besides Brazil, the African coast and then the Indian spice trade. All right? Spain is mostly Atlantic, Central and South America and Caribbean. Portugal is mostly Africa and India. Spain is mostly a settled empire, which means they colonized. They took over. They settled. They mixed with the population. They enslaved the population. Portugal was not really big enough, really, to be penetrators, if you will. They set up trade ports, with the exception of the Congo Kingdom, when I told you that they tricked a guy by the name of Zinga Biamba into wanting to be Portuguese. And then once he had kind of shown some, I don't know, flavor, if you will, for being Portuguese, changed his name to Dom Alfonso. Then they started to run into the interior and capture his family members and sell them into slavery. And then when he said, that's not cool, then they invaded him and then killed him while he was celebrating mass. Which is very cool, yeah.
Where's the gate for?
Right there.
Okay, I'll come up. Okay, I'll come up. Where can you come? Yeah.
All right. Last thing then, and then we can stop for pizza for a few minutes. Dutch did not come until the late 1500s. The English and the French predominantly were the 1600s. You might read about like Jacques Cartier. You might read about Henry Cabot. But for the most part, this is a Portuguese and Spanish thing. The Dutch really don't get involved until the 1600s, but when they do in a big way. And that's during that golden age of the Netherlands period. Okay? So that's hopefully useful to you. We're going to do two more of those through the course of our reviews. One of them is going to be the isms. One of them is going to be the Enlightenment. I think we can settle the scientific revolution because they've included a lot of it in the worksheet. And that's where we'll pick up when we get the pizza and we take our break. Let's take a break until 8, but we're really going to need to get restarted.